हरि ओम
हरि ओम Shoka was there in all the three people.
Dhritarashtra, Duryodhan and Arjun. All of them are attached. And that attachment causes sorrow, causes fear, causes insecurity. But it is only Arjun who approached the teacher in the right way, and you will see now in the second chapter how he surrenders. So how his dejection becomes a means to transform his entire life, to unite him with his own true self, to unite him with his own inner nature of his, innate nature of his also. So that is called as Vishad Yoga. That Vishad becomes Prasad for him. That's why it is called as a yoga. That his dejection became a means for him not only to gain self-knowledge, but because of him, keep making him as an instrument, Bhagavan gave the knowledge to everyone. Hence, even his Vishad becomes Prasad and becomes a yoga. Why? Because he surrendered to the Lord. If Arjun had not surrendered to the Lord, then Vishad would have remained Vishad only. So whenever we have a problem, whenever we have a sorrow or dejection, when we surrender to the Lord, that can transform that very sorrow. It can even eliminate that very sorrow. But when we don't surrender, then we keep brooding on our own sorrow. Now what happens with that? A person becomes a victim and gets into a mode of victimization, that life is unfair to me, why this has happened to me, I don't like this which has happened to me. And one broods, the more and more one broods, the more and more one feels self-pity, one feels miserable, one does not like, one wants to escape, all these things come. So the first chapter is also a beautiful explanation of how Vishad also can be converted into Prasad. That straight away puts an end to brooding the moment we surrender. And we open up ourselves to higher guidance. But when we refuse to surrender, our ego keeps on brooding and builds the ego. And the ego which is trapped inside that does not know a way out. So surrender opens up higher ways, and it also helps us to get out of that very vicious circle of victimization. When I become a victim, then I feel self-pity, I feel things are not appropriate, I am not able to perform better, when I don't perform better, again I think I am a victim because I don't get what I want. Of this circle, the vicious circle of victimization. That's called Vishad. One has to break that circle. How will one break it? By surrender to the Lord. So in this second chapter, it begins with a little bit of a summary of what Arjun's state was in the first chapter. So we see the first verse. This chapter is called Samkhya Yoga. Essence of the Gita is the second chapter. In fact, the Gita ideally should have ended with second chapter. There is nothing more to be said about the Gita than what is said in the second chapter. The rest of the chapters are only an elaboration of the second chapter. 72 verses in this chapter covers everything. Bhakti also, Karma Yoga also, Jnana also. A man of fulfillment who has reached that state, surrender of a student, everything covered. So it's a very comprehensive chapter and very, very important chapter. So let's begin. Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha.
Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha.
Atha Dvitiyo Dhyayaha.
Atha Dvitiyo Dhyayaha.
Tam Sanjaya Uvacha.
Sanjaya Uvacha.
Tam Tatha Kripaya Vishtam.
Tam Tatha Kripaya Vishtam.
Ashrupurna Kulekshanam. Vishidantamidam Vakyam.
Vishidantamidam Vakyam.
Uvacha Madhusudana.
Uvacha Madhusudana.
So Sanjay again narrates to Dhritarashtra that what is the scene now. He says, Kripaya Avishtam. Arjun was overwhelmed with compassion, Kripa. Misplaced compassion actually. Ashrupurna Kulekshana. And with tears in his eyes, Vishidantam, with a lot of sorrow in his heart. Idam Vakyam, he spoke this way. Who spoke? Madhusudana. Shri Krishna spoke to Arjun the following words, which he will tell now. And what was the state of Arjun? At all the three levels of his personality, he is shattered. Physically, Ashrupurna Kulekshana. He has thrown away his bow and arrow, does not want to fight, he is sitting there facing the Lord. Emotionally, completely overwhelmed with misplaced compassion. Intellectually, totally confused, doesn't know what to do. So, his entire personality has broken up. And last time we saw that if any one of these happens, emotionally one gets overwhelmed. Physically, one has some kind of attachment or identification in the body. Or intellectually, one gets confused. Sooner or later, it will affect the other two aspects of the personality. And that you can see in any aspect of our life. Physically, if we don't do our exercises, if we don't keep well, we have some sickness, it will affect our mind. We don't feel good about it. And slowly our thinking also becomes unclear. Same way, emotionally if I am upset at somebody telling me something, I may not even feel like eating food. Physically also I get affected. Intellectually also can't think logically, can't think clearly, because emotion is very disturbed. Or intellectually I am confused now, what to do I don't know. It is said one of the greatest causes of stress in modern life is indecision. Till one doesn't come to a decision, there will be a stress. And if you see today how many choices are available, my God. You can't decide. Earlier choices were simple. If you want to buy one item, you go, maybe two, three items will be there of the same, different brands. You just choose, take and come back. Today finished. One thing you want, there will be some 20,000 brands available. Now which one to choose, which to take, what to take, very confusing. Ordinary things can stress us out. Dress, my God. Which dress to buy, which dress to wear on this occasion, finished. One stress for that. Why? Because I didn't decide. There's so many choices available. So intellectually when one gets when there is indecision, then there is confusion, one lacks not being stressed. So any one of them can affect the other two aspects of the personality. So one of the teachings of the Gita is integration of body, mind, intellect is strength. Disintegration of body, mind, intellect is weakness. If the body, mind, intellect can come together, that is called as yoga. If body, mind, intellect does not work together, each one works in another direction. Body wants something, mind and intellect want something else. Mind wants something, body wants something else. If there is this kind of disintegration, that personality will be weak. And that person will not be able to face the challenges of life so easily. What Bhagavan did to Arjun through the knowledge is he integrated these three aspects. We will see more as we go along. But idea here is if you understand this point, that at what level was Arjun's breakdown? It was a total breakdown of his personality. And each one of us can land up in that state. If we don't pay attention to all the three aspects as a whole. See, we have to remember that life is a whole. Life is not parts. We as individuals are also whole, one. We may have different roles today. I am a mother also, I am a sister also, I am a spouse also, I am a whatever, friend also. I may have different roles, but I as a person, I am one only. And in that I have different aspects of my personality, body, mind, intellect, spirit, four aspects. Why is it that more and more people getting going through more and more stress today? Comforts, conveniences that we have today are much more than what was available earlier. We don't even have to move our finger. Everything is available to us sitting where we are. Now there is a new technology. With one remote, or why not by remote, with your phone, you can switch off the AC in your house, you can switch off the lights in your house, you can switch off the TV in your house, from wherever you are. You can even put it on, you can put on the AC from your phone, so that by the time you reach your house, room is very cool. Enough technology is available, you make your life more comfortable. But sitting amidst all that comfort, man sells. Kya ho gaya? Stress. Why? Because body, mind, intellect, soul, four aspects of the personality. Body, chalo, there is more awareness today, health is better, people are more health conscious. Intellect, enough and more of overdose of information available. Mind and spiritual aspect, hardly any training is done. So we grow up in such an imbalanced way that when we have to face challenges at the mental level, not up to it. What happened to Arjuna? Same problem. Why young people getting so stressed out and getting heart attacks? Because emotionally can't handle. Maximum stress comes not because of work. I don't know if you are aware of it. But that research says that maximum stress does not come because of work. Maximum stress comes because of the emotions and the relationships. Even the top CEOs and big people, when their emotions are not in harmony, if they have had a fight in the house, or if something is not going proper, or the son's career is not getting fixed properly, son is not listening, so many difficulties will come. I am misunderstood for no reason by my own team members. Unnecessarily somebody is blaming me. Anything can happen. Then emotions get disturbed. Bas, that causes so much of stress, chaos. So these three aspects plus the spiritual aspect. Spiritual aspect though hardly anybody even tries to take care. It has to go, you know, in our country, it cannot be accepted directly. It has to go to the West and then come back to us. Then we will accept it. Because unnecessary we need that approval of the West, for no reason. So yoga had to go out and come back. Then we say, wow, yoga, yoga. Everything has to go out. Gita went out, came back. Now everybody says, yes, Gita. Next is Upanishads have to go out. Each one has to take a turn. Go out, come back. Just one foreign return. That's all. So spiritual layer. You know, in corporate world, they used to measure IQ first, then EQ. Now they slowly measure the SQ. Spiritual quotient. Because how can we avoid? Human being has the four aspects. And if you see in Arjuna's case, the personality has completely broken down. Analysis of Sri Krishna is very clear. He says your body, mind, intellect has not become integrated because the main reason is that which fuels this body, mind, intellect, which is the spiritual aspect, that has been completely ignored. So there is no way that body, mind, intellect will work in unity. They will break down. And we find that. And it is so strange that in spite of people going through all kinds of trouble, stress, worry, tension, complete personality breakdown, they still think that spirituality is meant for old age and post-retirement plan. Maximum spirituality which one chooses to follow is be good, do good. That is enough. Is that going to fulfill that spiritual need or the spiritual layer of my personality? That is not going to fulfill that. That will fulfill mine, Maybe emotional need and social need of connecting with people, serving people, that's all. So here we find Krishna analyzes Arjuna's problem and then the solution he gives, he starts from the spiritual end. So here Arjuna's personality is totally broken down. He has tears in his eyes, threw away bow and arrow, sitting in front of the Lord, doesn't want to do his duty. And in that state of dejection when he is there, now Bhagavan starts. He does not sympathize with Arjuna at all. If you and I were there, listening to all the arguments of Arjuna, you would have said, yes, Arjuna, true. What you are saying is very true. Why should you kill all these people? They are your own people. The society will go through all the problems. And all the justifications Arjuna gives, and finally he says, I don't want to fight. If any of us were there, what we would have done? We said, chalo, I also will give you company. Let us both go into the forest. Bhagavan doesn't do anything. He straight whips him up. You see the answer of Bhagavan. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha.
Kutastvakashmalamidam.
Vishame samupasthitam. Anaryajushtamasvargyam. Akirtikaram Arjuna. So Bhagavan says, Kutastva Kashmalamidam. From where have you come upon this kind of dejection? Vishame Samupasthitam. Having come into the battlefield, this is the place of action. Now why are you in this confusion now? That should I fight, should I not fight? Many times that happens to us. We would have already taken a decision. Decision is gone, taken, over. But when I am actually facing that situation, then I wonder, maybe, should I do this, should I not do this? Indecision. He says, having come to this battlefield, now why are you in this state of dejection? Anarya Jushtam. This does not befit you. Arya literally means a gentleman. Please remember. Arya is not a tribe of people who have come from Central Asia, who invaded our country, who settled down on the banks of the Sindhu River, and they were called as the Aryans who wrote the Vedas. That entire Aryan invasion theory is a myth. There were no Aryans who came. Unnecessarily cooked up by Max Muller and Macaulay, and we were made to believe that our culture is inferior. Why? Because our Vedic scriptures are written by whom? People who are nomads, people who are barbarians. They came from Central Asia and these people wrote the Vedas. So intellectually nobody has any respect for the Vedas because barbarians wrote it thousands of years back. Why should we study it now? And that has been fed into our mind through our education system. Today enough historic evidence available to prove that there was no Aryan invasion at all. In Sanskrit the word Arya means a gentleman. And so Bhagavan says that this is not befitting a gentleman like you. Anarya Jushtam. Asvargyam. A warrior, when he fights in a war, if the person wins the war, one gets the kingdom. But if one dies in the war, they get what they call as Veer Swarga. As a brave warrior, valiantly he fought, and so he gets Swarga. So he says, you will not get Swarga, neither you will get good name here, Akirtikaram. This kind of escape, you will only get bad name. So why has this rejection come upon you? Why are you doing all this? And then comes a bigger way. He does not sympathize at all. Now comes very important words. I mean, one can even memorize these words if you want. Klaibhyam Masmagam Partha.
Klaibhyam Masmagam Partha.
Naitatvai Upapadyate.
Naitatvai Upapadyate.
Kshudram Hridaya Daurbalyam.
Kshudram Hridaya Daurbalyam.
Tyaktvotishtha parantapa.
Tyaktvotishtha parantapa.
इसेस क्लाइबियम मास्मगम पार्थ, ओ पार्थ डोंट एक्ट लाइक अ यूनक, नहि तत्व युगोपद्यते, दिस डज नॉट बिफिट यू. क्षुद्रम हृदय दौर्बल्यम, दिस वीकनेस ऑफ द हार्ट इज वेरी लो, वेरी मीन. त्यक्त्वा उत्तिष्ठ परंतप, यू ड्रॉप दिस एंड राइज ओ परंतप. सो दिस इज अ वेरी ब्यूटिफुल वर्स ऑफ द गीता वेर इज अ कॉल टू इनवोक इनर स्ट्रेंथ. भगवान सेज क्लैबियम मास्मगम, डोंट एक्ट नाइदर लाइक अ मैन नॉर लाइक अ वुमन. This is not befitting you because you are Partha. One of the meanings of Partha is, Partha literally means one who is the son of Pritha or Kunti. But Partha has another meaning also. Pritha means earth. So Partha means the son of the soil. Means each one of us. The third meaning of Partha is very beautiful. Pa means Bhagwan, Pati, one who protects. Artha means one who desires. So one who desires the Lord alone, a seeker, is called as Partha. So he says this doesn't befit a seeker. Because who is Partha? One who always chooses the best is Partha. If in any situation I respond in this way, then I find out that is this the best thing to be done. I may like it, I may not like it, but is this the best way to respond? Then I am Partha, then I am a seeker. Somebody insults me, very easy for me also to retaliate. But is that the best way to respond? If I can hold back and I can control, then I am being Partha. I feel like postponing my duty right now. I have to finish some amount of work. But this IPL is going to come. So I immediately feel like, not today, tomorrow I will do this work. Is that the best way to respond? Procrastination. So at every moment if I ask myself that, am I being Partha? Am I responding in the best way possible? Because if I don't respond in the best way possible, I become a victim of my own mind. So he says, O Partha, this does not defeat you. You are unnecessarily becoming a victim of your own mind. And now blaming the situations outside. That does not befit a seeker. A seeker is the one who always takes charge of one's life. And whatever happens in my life, I am responsible for it. I am not going to blame outside people. They may only, maybe 10%, 5%, they may only contribute that much. But other 90% of the response is in my hands. So if a seeker understands this, one will not blame. Arjun right now is in a state where not only he is not taken charge of the situation, he has become a complete defeatist. I am not doing his duty. And whom is he blaming for it? All outside forces. He does not say that he is deluded. That he will say after this week. Till now what he has said? Omens are not proper, body is not proper, ahimsa is the supreme dharma, society will get destroyed. All the external reasons he gave. Bhagavan says this doesn't befit you. Because this is not befitting a seeker who will always choose the best response to give. And who will never feel victimized, who will never feel that my life is not in my control. Now you are sitting like a defeatist. What is the reason? He says, Hridaya Daurbalyam. Only your weakness of your heart. The first thing that any spiritual teacher will do is to make us aware that the cause of the problem is not outside us. The cause of the problem is within us only. In fact, one philosopher, he said very nicely, he said, you don't have a problem. You are the problem. From a highest spiritual standpoint, that is a fact. We don't have a problem. We ourselves are the problem. That ego is a problem, nothing else. So anyway, the idea here is, till I keep blaming outside circumstances, I can't change my life, because I will remain helpless. Government is like this, and spouse is like this, and business is like this, and our employers are like this, and all kinds of things I will keep on blaming. Just keep feeling miserable, nothing else I can do about it. But the moment I say, no, the cause of the problem is inside me, then I can start finding out what is the issue, where am I stuck, where am I confused, where am I attached, and I can work on it. So Gurudev always said that the suffering does not depend on the external situation, it depends on the texture of our mind. So if our mind is positive, is clear, no sorrow. If our mind is confused, negative, we will keep blaming everybody outside. Strong people are those who don't blame outside people. In spite of all the difficulties, they will still achieve what they have to achieve. That is called mental strength. And you take any examples. This Apple which we use, Apple computer and all that. Steve Jobs, what all he went through in his life, he was orphaned, adopted by somebody else. His own partners kicked him out of the job. Again, after some time, they brought him back. What all happened in his life? He got cancer. But in spite of all that, went on to achieve. Because weak people don't blame circumstances. Weak people blame circumstances. Strong people don't blame. So here he says, Shudram Hridayatava Balyam. And this is one thing which we have to very clearly know, that to face life, we require inner strength. We don't require skills. You require skills to make a living, but we require strength to face life. So we, based on this shloka, our formula which we have made is, success without stress is equal to skill plus strength. If I want to be successful, and I want to enjoy that success, not be stressed out about it, then what do I need? I need two things. I need skills and I need strength. Now skills are specific to my job, my field or profession. So if I am a doctor or engineer or a teacher or a computer programmer or a whatever, jeweler, anything, businessman, each aspect has its own skills that one requires. And I have to gain competency in that. I have to gain expertise in that. And I may have to gain expertise in certain other general skills like communication skills and presentation skills and all those things. But by itself, skills cannot make me strong to face the unpredictable challenges of life. For that, I require inner strength. And that inner strength, if we kindle in an individual, but that person becomes capable of facing anything in life after that. That's the actual purpose of education. It is to equip a person to face the life with strength, with courage, with confidence, with clarity. It is not to make that person more competitive enough than other people to learn, to win and to achieve success. So what if a child gets 95% and some other child gets 70%? Maybe the admission part of it will be difficult, okay, because of scarcity of institutions and all that. So we will not get admission to a particular institution. But beyond that, what? And yet, amount of emphasis that we put on that marks and those skills, we don't understand only how much importance is to be given to strength. And the same fellow, you will find so many of them, bright people, committing suicide, going into depression, cannot handle relationship breakups, getting into drugs, what all happens? Why? Because strength was just not there, that's all. So if we understand this clearly, we will give, if not more importance, at least equal importance to the strength aspect. Even the schools today, when they speak about holistic education in our schools, what do they mean? They mean they will have PT, they will have extracurricular activity, they will have debate, they have elocution, they have nature club, environmental club, this club, that club. Who speaks about inner strength? He let the children get empowered with the knowledge by which they can face life and its difficulties come what may. Even simple things, anger management, they don't teach. Stress management, they will not teach. How to forgive, one doesn't know. How to let go of some insistence, one doesn't know. And all these are required when one goes out. And then one wonders, ki, nobody taught me all this. Parents are not going to teach, in the house is not going to be taught, in the school it is not taught. How will the child learn? What happened to Arjun is this. Why should he collapse? Because he did not have this requisite inner strength. He did not know how to tap the inner strength. The difference between Arjun's character and Yudhishthira's character we have to understand. See, both of them spent 12 years in the forest. Arjun spent 12 years to acquire skill. Yudhishthira spent 12 years to cleanse his heart of any form of hatred that he had. Draupadi used to tell Yudhishthira that, what, are you a man? That how can they have done such horrible things to you? How are you even sitting quietly like this? Don't you feel like, you know, breaking all kinds of rules and just go and attack them now? Why should we follow rules? When they have humiliated us so badly, why should we follow rules? And the reply that Yudhishthira gives is very powerful. He says, I also feel the insult and I also feel the humiliation, but I don't follow rules for them, I follow rules for myself. Because I am answerable to Dharma, I am not answerable to them. And I am answerable only to Dharma, and I will ensure that I live my Dharma. I compromise from my Dharma, that's why we are in this situation. Because he says, I could not follow the Dharma of a husband properly, and I put you on that, what do you call it, game of dice. Because I compromise from Dharma, I am in this situation right now. And the more I compromise in Dharma, the more weaker we will become. So I will also take the revenge. I also know what they have done is not fair, but I will follow Dharma and I will do it in a dharmic way. And for 12 years, he did that penance whereby he cleansed his heart of complete hatred. No hatred at all for Kauravas. And if you see Arjun, he didn't do all that. He cultivated his skills, he got weapons, this, that, everything. And finally, when he comes to the battlefield, what Bhagavan tells him to do? Bhagavan tells him to do Tato Yuddhaya Yujyasva. You fight for the sake of fighting. Don't fight because you want to take revenge, and this is not a personal war. You forgive them from inside but fight outside. Now see, ultimately you have to come there only. Bhagavan did not tell him that don't fight. This is the beauty of the Gita, if you understand the Gita. If there is adharma being done to us, Gita is not telling you passive resistance. Gita is telling you active resistance to evil, but nothing from inside. Don't resist with hate from inside, because then you are destroying yourself. From inside you forgive. Okay, they are done, they did. But outside when I have to fight, it's a part of my dharma to fight. I have to fight. Dharma of Ram in that yuga was different, and dharma of Krishna in this yuga is very different. Ram forgave from inside. He also actually fought outside. He had to fight Ravan, so he fought. But he had no enmity against Ravan. But he did not fight with mantra at all. He just forgave from inside. He did not go back to mantra and say, "Arey, you fool, you are the reason why I went to forest. And you know, unjustly you sent me away, and I am going to, what do you call, take my revenge, and I am going to banish you from the kingdom and all that." Nothing. Because then he just forgave from inside and left it. In this case, all the chances of doing that are gone. Now they have to fight. Pandavas have to fight the Kauravas. So Bhagavan tells him, you just cleanse your heart, have no attachments, and you fight. So what does that show? Yudhishthira and Arjun, both of them, they spend their time. Ultimately, at the war, they both had to come to that same level. Arjuna was lacking in that inner cleansing, inner strength. So Bhagavan had to invoke that and push him to that level. Otherwise he had collapsed. So the need for inner strength is tremendous. We are not answerable to anybody else. We follow values because we are answerable to ourselves. And following the value, we live a strong life. That's all. He says, Hridaya Dhava Balyam. What makes a person strong from inside is the values, is the adherence to dharma, is the clarity about the purpose of life, and ultimately the spiritual knowledge of the truth. That is inner strength. If that one can hold on to, universal values, duty or dharma. So at the physical level it is your duties, physical and emotional level. Intellectual level it is the value system. And spiritual level it is the knowledge of the self. These three, that's all. Simple. If these three we know, we will sail through difficulties of life. When we say duty, it means everything. Not only duties towards external people, duty towards our own body, mind, intellect, soul also. So a concept of duty based on values, do it for a higher purpose, focus on the spiritual truth. This much if we have in life, we are strong in life. Then everything else will follow, because in values everything comes. Ahimsa also comes, forgiveness also comes, truth comes, straightforwardness, charity, everything comes in values. So if a person lives that way, and you will see in the Gita, this is the solution Bhagavan will give. Repeatedly he will stress about values. At least 4 or 5 places there are different sets of values which are given in the Gita. And how to live them. And he shows Arjuna the way to live them in a battlefield. Don't think that the values that Gita will give us is, you know, okay, values, so we also know Swamiji. Nothing new about them. But the values which he can give in the battlefield is being given here. And he makes Arjuna give those. So if Arjuna can leave that in battlefield, you and I can happily live in our life is not like this kind of a huge war. It is small, small challenges which are coming. So, Kshudram Hridaya Dhava Balyam. He whips up Arjuna saying, don't blame anybody. This is your weakness of heart. And invoke that inner strength. So, our formula is what? Success without stress is equal to skill plus strength. See, skills, if they are even little lesser, that doesn't make a difference. But strength should not become less. That you see even at physical level. Now, when our strength becomes, immunity goes down even a bit, what happens? Immediate infection. And how much time we spend in cultivating skills, my God. I said this even in the Gita lecture earlier, in 17th chapter when we spoke here at Jain College. That our child will go to every class, handwriting class and holiday, this horse riding class and karate class and swimming class and dance class, music class, this class, that class, all classes. And finally there is 1 half an hour left somewhere. One will say, Swamiji, is there a Balvihar class happening anywhere during this time? Okay, squeeze that also. And when the exam comes now exam time, no? Which class goes out first? Balvihar class. That which will give us that strength to face life, put that aside first. All other classes, same way for this Gita class you will see. Every other appointment is over, if I am free then I will come. There are those who understand the importance of this, they will say no, 3 days a month, 3 hours a month is an investment that I can do for myself. Everything else can wait. Why should I compromise with this? Because this is required for my strength. There are those people who attend our weekly class, which we call Devi Group class. And over the years they have seen that one class in that week And 1.5 hours of Devi group class or that study group class, when they do the discussion, they come in touch with this. It gives them enough intellectual clarity and strength to face the next 1 week. And when they don't do that, over a period of time, suppose there's a big gap, they themselves find that the way they respond to situations is so different. What is the importance of strength in our life? We have to keep telling ourselves. There is no situation outside which can be so terrible that can bog us down totally. It can do that only if I am weak. So as a spiritual student, one will never blame anyone outside. People who are so strong, you know, one Kargil warrior, he was there. His name is Major D.P. Singh. Did I tell you about him? Blade Runner, right? First class I told you?
Yes.
Yeah. What strength in his mind? Lost his leg, but became India's Blade Runner. Lost the leg in Kargil War. But no regret, nothing. So that way one has to have that strength. So Kshudram Hudaya Dhaur Balyam Tyaktva Uttishta Parantapa. So he says you drop this and you write, oh Parantapa. Parantapa means one who has done lot of tapas. So he did lot of tapas to get the skills. Also Parantapa means one who is a scorcherer of foes. So he has already defeated the Kauravas once. So one who creates fear in the minds of the enemy. So Bhagavan is telling this to him to motivate. Partha and Parantapa, these are two words which mean Arjun's name. And both these are to invoke the qualities of Arjun, telling him that you are the one who responds with the best choice every time. This does not befit you. And you are the one who scorches the enemies. Why are you sitting in this kind of a dejected state? So just to motivate him, to pep him up and let him come out of this situation. So when Bhagavan has said this, Arjun gives the last resistance before he surrenders. He introspects. Till now he was giving all kinds of reasoning outside. Now he introspects and he says, okay, see, now my main problem is this. Arjuna uvacha.
Katham bhishmamaham sankhye.
Dronam cha madhusudana. Ishubhit pratiyotsyami. Ujarhavari sudana. Arjun now confesses. He says, see, my main problem are only these two, Bhishma and Drona. Katham Bhishma Maham Sankhe. How can in the war I fight Bhishma? Dronam cha Madhusudana. Oh Madhusudana, one who has destroyed a demon called Madhu. How can I fight Bhishma and Drona? Ishubhi, with arrows. They are the worshipful ones to me. Puja Rhava Arisudana. Arisudana means one who kills the enemies. He says, you kill the demon called Madhu, you have killed the enemies. But why are you telling me to kill Bhishma and Drona, who are worshipful for me? How can I even fight with them? I can't even have a verbal duel with them. Now I have to fight with arrows. What he really means is, he has already fought with them with arrows in that exile time. What he means is, I have to actually kill them. How do you expect me to kill them? They are people who are so worshipful. And these are the two people where I am attached. If Bhishma and Drona he had not seen there at that time, it would not have been this condition for him. Because he has no attachment towards Duryodhan and any of them. Only Bhishma and Drona, two. So one more important lesson to learn in the first chapter of the Gita is, it is not the number of attachments that are a problem to us. It is the intensity of attachment which is our problem. one attachment, and to that, if one is bound, finished. That attachment can destroy us totally. Just one person or one attachment is enough. So one can't justify. One can't say that, you know, everything else I've given up, Swamiji, but this one attachment, you know, my son. One attachment to sleep. No attachment. Any attachment can destroy us. You look at Arjun's case now. Only two people he is attached to. Who? Bhishma and Drona. Dhritarashtra is better than him. He is attached to only one. Duryodhana. And Duryodhana is not attached to anybody. That fellow is attached to power. I must have full control, full power. One attachment is enough. Yudhishthira was also attached to what? No. Dharma, he was not attached to Dharma. He was steadfast in Dharma. Attachment to Dharma and steadfastness of Dharma are two different things. He was attached to this gambling. Second time, who told him to go? First time, he lost everything. And luckily, everything was given back to him. If you remember the story. Because Draupadi was ill-treated so badly there, his Gandhari told Dhritarashtra that you better give back everything, otherwise the curse of this Draupadi will destroy our entire clan. So they gave back everything. Then again they sent an invitation. And what was the attachment of Yudhishthira? He said, I can't say no to such an invitation. Why you can't say no? Tell no. That I'm not interested to play. Okay. But attached. Just one attachment. You know, Mahabharata is very beautiful. One attachment anywhere anybody has, that becomes the cause of the downfall. And after reading whole Mahabharata, we will still say, is it okay? I can be attached now. Thoda. I'm a householder finally. Little attachments are natural. Then sorrow also is natural. Then don't ask, I should not be miserable. We spoke about it, no, earlier. That attachment and sorrow are directly proportional. The deeper the attachment, greater the sorrow. Now he says, Bhishma and Drona, two attachments. How can I fight with them? They are the people. Oh, he forgot that what about his steadfastness to Dharma? Now they are standing for Adharma. You know, Bhishma also was attached to his vow. And do you know that because of that attachment to his vow, how many problems happened? This whole Mahabharata would not have happened if the fellow was not attached to his vow. And what was the stupid vow that he took? Ultimate analysis, Bhagavan only condemns him. He says, who told you to be loyal to that throne of Hastinapur? How do you know that the person who is going to be sitting there will be a dharmic person always? You did not marry for the sake of your father. Okay, that vow you can take. Okay. That okay. So that my children will not stake a claim to the throne. So I want to do this for my father. So you took that vow. You should have stopped with that. But then he went ahead to say that whoever will be sitting on the throne, I will be loyal to him. For what? Unnecessary. In fact, when it comes to a question of dharma, one can even break a vow. That's what Krishna teaches him. That he lifts the wheel. Krishna took a vow saying what? I will not fight in the battlefield. No shastra I will lift. And Mahabharata is a very interesting analysis. On the ninth day, on the eighth day or something, eighth day, this Duryodhana goes to Bhishma and he says that you are fighting on our side and still eight full days have gone by without any result. Because you are partial, you are not fighting properly. And that Bhishma gets very upset. He says, tomorrow, either I am alive or Arjun is alive. if Krishna does not lift weapons. And the way he fights on the ninth day, terrible. One arrow he shoots on Arjuna, which would have hit Arjuna straight here. And Bhagwan actually ducks the horses. And that arrow goes from the crown is gone. Bhagwan gets angry, saying, what kind of a fight Arjuna is putting up? What a fool he is. He is also still acting with all his attachment. Bhishma is fighting in such a fierce way, but he is not giving his best. He jumps down, lifts the wheel of a chariot and charges at Bhishma. There Bhishma stops and he folds his hands. By doing that act, what Krishna proved to him? That you may have a personal vow, but for what is that personal vow taken? That vow is taken for the sake of dharma. If dharma itself is in danger, what's the problem? What's the point in following your vow? In this situation of Mahabharata war, dharma itself is in danger. Why should Bhishma stick to his vow of being loyal to the kingdom, to the king, who is anarchic, not required? So for the sake of a higher purpose, if a lower vow is to be dropped, there is nothing wrong in that. So in Mahabharata you will find everywhere, every fellow is attached to one thing, and that becomes the cause of their destruction. Either they destroy themselves, or because of that, others also go through trouble. If if Bhishma had accepted Satyavati said. Satyavati's father took the vow from Bhishma that his daughter's children only should be the kings. Now both his children have died. Vichitravirya also died. Chitrangada also died. Now there is no way that the Kuru Vamsha will go ahead. And Satyavati herself is telling Bhishmacharya that why don't you marry? Now the purpose for which he gave that vow was already fulfilled, no? Satyavati got married to his father. And the mother herself is saying now, but no, maine Bhishma pratigya li. It is unnecessary. When mother herself is saying that why don't you marry now? If he had married, the whole course of things would have been different. Karna was also attached. To whom? To Duryodhana. Bhagwan goes to him also and says, look, why don't you just... You know that Kunti is your mother. He reveals that to him. Because Karna, whole life he has been thinking that who is that mother of mine who dropped me into the basket and put me into the... Saryu, who is that lady who did not like me and who just abandoned me? He was very desperate to know who is that lady. And finally Krishna tells him that Kunti is your mother. Karna can't handle it. At that point in time Bhagwan tells him also that you go now. Go be at the side of the Pandavas, because if you go this war will not happen. You are the main strength of Duryodhana. But Karna says no. He may be having his own reasoning, no doubt. Each of them had their own reasoning, Bhishma, Karna, all of these people. But when it is put in front of dharma, none of these will be valid. However great the friend may be, if it is a question of dharma and adharma, the friend is not going to come after death. What is going to come with us? Is dharma only. So each of them, if you see, Arjuna is attached. Duryodhana is attached, Dhritarashtra is attached, Bhishma is attached, Dronacharya is attached. Everyone. One big message from Mahabharata is, don't be attached. Because any type of attachment will lead us to sorrow. Any type of attachment. Very difficult to not be attached. But that's what the Gita teaches us. How to attach to the higher, so that I drop attachment to the lower. More about it we will see on Wednesday. So this is where Arjuna is right now, and next he will surrender now. Then starts the teaching of the Gita. So this month we have next week on next class on Wednesday and then on Friday. One question I want to ask is, how many of you feel that Friday is difficult to attend because of being closer to the weekend? Anyone? Okay. Two people. Okay. Because otherwise if we shift, suppose we do Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, comfortable for all of you? Instead of Monday, Wednesday, Friday, not this month, next month onwards. In 3 days it will be continuous also and it will be done. Okay, so May onwards, or to Wednesday's class, I will announce the dates. So we will take up for the next 3-4 months the dates I will tell you. We will try to do it Monday, Tuesday and Wednesday. Only thing is, on Tuesday when you come, there is a class happening here till 7 o'clock. That is a Kathak class which happens. So those of you who come, may quickly help us to organize up this place. Jagdish is here, but he alone should not be doing it. Some of us can just come quickly and help him to set this up. It will be great. Right. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnamidachate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om.